An enormous amount of material has been put on the table in this first session. So what I'm going to try and do is take us through the one slice, one particular cut through all of this. The journey toward the Fourth Industrial Revolution has in fact been a long one. And in fact, Dr. Sakong and we 20 years ago had the honor, I had the honor of working with you on the semiconductor issues back at the very beginning of this transition. And Korea has in fact been a real leader along that entire journey. And now what we're hearing from our various distinguished speakers is that Korea must now begin to consider strategies to maintain that leadership and the consequences for society of this new industrial revolution. Back when we started the Berkeley Roundtable, the group of people who were involved with us, Bob Noyce, Jerry Sanders, Charlie Spork, Steve Jobs, all really thought they were creating a utopia. They saw themselves as generating this new world long before we called it the Fourth Industrial Revolution. In fact, there were some skeptics, people who thought that we were going to end up destroying jobs and the like. And the question partly is, where are we in that balance? And in fact, now a new question has begun to emerge, which is also, and importantly, is the digital revolution itself over? This secular stagnation, the drop in productivity that people are pointing to, in fact has led some to conclude that we have come to the end of this industrial revolution, that it isn't really quite what it was cracked up to be, that it had limited scope, and that in fact it only affected a few sectors, that it limited power of technology. Some of you who are economists know the now famous book, The Rise and Fall of American Growth, which in fact has been replicated in argument all around the world. The question is universal, even if it's posed in the American context. But I think what we're concluding here today is that Robert Gordon is just wrong. That in fact the digital wave is not only just beginning, not only in the middle of it, but it's in some ways just beginning. We're sweeping from pure information services into what we at the United States and at Berkeley have called services with everything. It's a story of the Internet of Things, of a transformation of manufacturing, of the emergence of digital platforms, of the importance of big data. And what I want to focus on in part is computation-intensive automation, what's loosely called artificial intelligence, big learning, machine learning, and the like. Where we are exactly in the wave is for now speculation and argument. But for Korea, the question of how it deploys these new technologies, these new drivers, will in fact be the crucial question. The issue came up in the previous session, but I want to reframe it slightly, which is the OECD data on productivity suggests that it is not, that in fact the productivity frontier is moving forward very rapidly, but not everyone is getting there. It's the sector by sector, it's the leading 10% of the firms. The other 90% are way behind. Now, the interesting question here is why? And it's not just digitization. The question is, nobody really is quite sure as to what is accounting for that enormous variation. But the effective deployment of these new technologies will be critical in trying to pull the entire economy along and for those countries to, in fact, try and be in a leadership position across the array of sectors. Now, to address the range of questions that others have raised and that I'm concerned with, I want to look at two phases of the digital revolution to clarify and identify what we're calling these drivers. Globalization and the emergence of network services is one phase, and the phase of the cloud, or the era of the cloud, is the other. Now, globalization and the Institute for Global Economy emerges with globalization really is entangled what we've come to call the industrial commodity trap. The industrial commodity trap has led to a set of competitive adaptations, which is services with everything. Now, let me explain what I mean. Globalization is partly that everything is made from bits and pieces around the world, assembled parts are produced in one place, moved to another, subsystems are assembled, those subsystems are assembled then further into another place. people like Greg Mulholland's firm is producing input and insight into the underlying materials, all of the pieces are, in a sense, broken apart. And then they're recomposed in a way, and it's not just into particular goods or sectors. There's a focus in Silicon Valley in the generation of new products, new sector ideas, entire new systems. And in Shenzhen, for example, obviously there's a production, an intensive assembly and production apparatus, so that in fact the recomposition happens around phases of the production process. The point here is that at each node in this production system, in these value chains, there's intense price competition. And wherever there's intense price competition, profits are eroded. The ability to sustain innovation is undercut and undermined. So firms of all sorts then want to try and escape from what we're then calling the industrial commodity trap, the fact that everybody's competing about everything. Now, in fact, there are many ways of doing it. Branding is one, obviously, but there are two that I want to emphasize. One is the constant, very rapid product development. We all know that. This week, Apple came out with its latest product, and obviously part of Samsung's problem is precisely that its latest product has been difficult to do. I should note that rapidly integrating of hardware, electronics, and software is very difficult. It's not just Samsung that's having problems with this. I noticed that Foxconn and other companies are as well. But equally important, what we've seen is the emergence of products embedded in digital service networks. Several of the commentators in the prior session emphasized that, and I want to make something more of that. There is a real blurring of the borders between services and manufacturing. Partly, of course, people can contract out manufacturing, they can contract for research and development, and they can contract for services. But as was mentioned in the last session, increasingly value becomes in the service networks, the delivery of an outcome. It's not the iPod, as beautiful as it was in the beginning, that was so crucial as much as it was the iTunes system. It is not simply the fact that Michelin now not only sells tires, but it is willing to sell you a service system to maintain and minimize the cost of the tires you use because it's generating the data on what's going on with the tires. One of my favorite instances is a company in Finland called Cargotec. And Cargotec builds equipment for ports. And I became particularly fascinated because I started telling this crane story in Finland one day, and the other speaker was the CEO of Cargotec. I hadn't been paying attention. But what Cargotec really does is that they faced a problem, which is they make cranes, but so do the Chinese. And so the Chinese cranes were pretty inexpensive. So Cargotec said, well, why don't we sell port management services? And they bought a platform from a company in Oakland, California, a few miles from where I live, that provides a platform. Now, in fact, if you had IT-embedded equipment in your cranes and your other port equipment, you could manage your ports more effectively. So the offering became, buy our port management system, your ports will be cheaper, forget about the cost of the Chinese cranes, it doesn't really matter. So for me, it was part of that shift. The shift that IBM went through of shifting from just selling mainframe computers to selling Watson services. So that is part of this process that is really changing the very character of competition in what we're loosely calling the fourth industrial revolution, which we tend to call the digital transformation, but we're all talking about the same thing. But those processes are now accelerated because we're entering an era of abundant computing. It's the era of the cloud. And in a sense, the cloud, for those of us who are semi-technical, is the child of abundance. What I mean by that is we saw the numbers on the decline, the extreme increase in availability of computing and the decrease in pricing, at which point you could start to, in fact, manage computing in new and different kind of ways. So I'm going to run very quickly through several dimensions of this. For cloud is, in fact, not about where computing is done, it's about how it's done. And it's enabled by this enormous abundance of computing resources, which permit virtualization and permit abstraction. And without going into all the technical details in the next 20 minutes or something like that, it in fact permits a new way of approaching computing. And for the user, the critical thing is it makes the availability of computing power widely available without having to put into place your own complete computing system. So that, in fact, a friend of mine built a company that she sold to IBM back in the day for $100 million. So that was real money once upon a time, right? I mean, so she sold it to IBM, and as she said, she could now build the same company, build the same set of products for $50,000 on her credit card by engaging with Amazon Web Services. And that changes the game. It means that companies like Greg's can, in fact, get started without having to have an endowment of $5 or $10 million for the computing resources. It speeds the development of applications, and value moves up the stack, if you will, from the infrastructure into applications. I should add that for the provider, scale matters, but that's not our topic today. So the cloud, once you have all this resources, facilitates a number of the things that we've been discussing. It facilitates platforms, it facilitates the management of big data, and it comes to computation-intensive automation, which is where I want to focus at least a few of my limited minutes. So the platforms, which is what we've tended to call the rise of the platform economy, because, in fact, so much now runs on what are, in fact, digital platforms. There's a technical computer definition. We can skip that for now. But what platforms really are algorithmic-enabled cyberplaces where constituents can act or transact. They're a particular kind of marketplace, a particular kind of social community. And those platforms have a whole array of diversity. They're service and entertainment platforms, Uber, YouTube, goods markets, Etsy, Amazon. Labor markets, obviously, are transformed and changed by the availability of these platforms. And if this was a slightly different conversation, I'd want to focus on exactly how labor is affected. And I must say I was very encouraged by the remarks of the Vice Minister earlier that the whole issue of flexible security as a conversation has arrived in Korea, because, in fact, you can't just get a flexible economy by displacing and damaging workforces. They have to be sophisticated and committed, and therefore the question of how to create transition and change is different from the way in which things took place in rapid development years. And then, of course, there are platforms beyond the consumer space. The previous speakers actually emphasized manufacturing and the Internet of Things, both of which run on these various kinds of platforms, of these digital platforms that create the interlinks and functionality. The consequences of these digital platforms is partly that you can do different things better, transportation linkages such as Uber, partly because you can do entirely different things that were never possible before. Google search is certainly one of those things. But from a Korean standpoint, part of the question is where are platforms emerging? And in fact, I think one of the questions I'd want to ask, and I don't have any preliminary answer, is that the bulk of platforms are emerging in China and in the areas around Silicon Valley and to some extent in Europe. And the question is, what does it take to become a source and player in this platform world? From a standpoint of policy, we'll come back to that later, but the issue is who sets the game, who sets the corporate rules, and what is the battle between public and private governance? Because every platform is a set of parameters. Those parameters are in fact rules of the game. And when in fact we're told, as Dr. Fry had said, let's get rid of personal bias when you're hungry, who gets to review the biases built into the platforms? I really would like to know that question before I completely dispense with people. Now, data is in fact the fuel in this platform era. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about it. It's used both to drive the analysis of marketplaces, what people want, what customers want, and, as Greg's firm would do, to develop products out of the data that's there. Crucial issues are where the sources of that data comes from, and, in fact, who is, in fact, and what the analytic tools used to use it are, and who owns the data, and what the rules are for how the data can be used. But we can come back to those later. Now I want to come to the what is for me one of the crucial elements here, which is the transformation of work and production, computation-intensive automation, which includes issues such as Industry 4.0. The conversation has roughly circled around artificial intelligence and machine learning, both of which have been mentioned here today. What, in fact, is important is that for corporations, the question is how to use these tools to create competitive advantage. And for society, the question is, what does this do to the society? What does it do to employment and jobs and work? There are two alternatives, which have been hinted at here, but let's highlight them. These tools can be used to displace work and workers, or they can be used to augment skills, to upgrade the workforce, to try, in fact, generate a smarter workforce, a smarter workplace. Displacing work means oftentimes let's figure out what the exact tasks are now and just replace them. Augmenting it means rethinking production systems from top to bottom. Now, it's evident, and Dr. Fry's work and others, the McKinsey work, is evident that automation touches much of work and employment. But the critical questions remain. How much is displaced? How much is created? How much is transformed? And we just don't know that right now. We want to ask the question of what influences that balance of displacement, creation, and transformation. And I want to mention two things because it brings us back to the intelligence augmentation story, which in my mind is one of the crucial questions we have to address. The first is the algorithmic dilemma. What I mean by the algorithmic dilemma is anything which can be routinized can be computed and automated. Most of automation, however, most of the routine can be copied. So you're back where you started in a trap, as it were, because you're back in a trap of basically competing on price. Then, in fact, the question is the high road to adaptation is continuous innovation, and it's innovation using people. So the question is, does data-sustained innovation require human imagination and implementation? And the answer is maybe. And then it is maybe true all the way through the economy, from how you use a lawnmower up through how you design the system. Remember, we all remember the days of secretarial pools. Lots of people sitting and typing up what we all supposedly brilliantly said. And now along came a user interface called Word, called Windows, and suddenly all of the secretaries became assistants because they didn't have to do the same kinds of things. There were just as many jobs, but the jobs and the workforce and the workplace was very different. So one issue is what happens with the algorithmic dilemma. The second issue here is, do we treat workers as a cost to be minimized or as an asset to be promoted? Even a company like Walmart's in the United States has found that, in fact, if it cuts wages and breaks up work hours, it gets worse services in its stores and they don't do well. They've just recently announced they're increasing wages, experimenting with increasing wages, and treating workers in very different kinds of ways. So we're back to the balance. Will robots and software simply replace workers, or will we redesign work to take advantage of human cognition and capacities? How will cyber be integrated into production? And I should say my fascination with Industry 4.0 is partly because Germany has very little to sell other than skilled workers, skilled companies, and it has to figure out how to not just allow cyber to displace all of those abilities. And in that context, what choices will Korea make? The choices are at a point at which the concerns of the firm and the concerns of public policy come together. The concerns are competitiveness for the firm, productivity, employment for society. And in fact, from a Korean standpoint, it seems to me there's one shot. Smart workers, smart and secure products and services, and a branded society of smart and secure fourth industrial revolution. So what I would suggest or propose, and then I'll conclude, is that we invent, maybe all of us here today, the Korea Prize. And the Korea Prize is for coming up with solutions that augment capacity, augment intelligence and ability, that we create a competition not just about the displacement of work, but as a conscious thing to try and think through how to use these to augment and improve our workforce and our society. I should say Berkeley has a couple of institutes we would be delighted to play with you on that regard. But the next session will take up the implications. What are the choices for Korea? Where will Korea fit in this new order? I have a lot to say about that, but let's wait until the next session. Thank you.